Good evening, everyone, and welcome. And it's a great honor and pleasure to introduce Laleh Khalili for this evening's lecture. My name is Rochelle Davis, and I'm an associate professor in the Center for Contemporary Arab Studies in the School of Foreign Service. So Professor Khalili is a professor of Middle East politics at SOAS, University of London. And I'll do a bio here. Her first book, Heroes and Martyrs of Palestine, The Politics of National Commemoration, drew on ethnographic research in the Palestinian refugee camp of Burj al-Barajneh in Lebanon, and focused on the particular genres of commemoration, from the heroic practices during the heady days of third worldism to the tragic discourses of an era in which NGOs are ascendant. She also edited Modern Arab Politics and co-edited with Gillian Schwedler a book titled Policing and Prisons in the Middle East, Formations of Coercion. Her most recent book, Time in the Shadows, Confinement and Counterinsurgency, was published by Stanford University Press in 2013 and drew on interviews with former detainees of Abu Ghraib, Guantanamo Bay, and various Israeli detention camps and prisons, as well as military officers, guards, and interrogators. And she combined that along with a large number of archival sources to show the counterinsurgencies in practices of detention in liberal counterinsurgencies from the Boer War until the present. This book was the winner of the Susan Strange Best Book Prize of the British International Studies Association and the 2014 Best Book Award of the International Political Sociology Section of the ISA. She's here to talk to us today about a project she's currently working on logistics and maritime transport infrastructures in the Arabian Peninsula. She secured a grant from the Economic and Social Research Council to explore the development of cities, infrastructures, ports, and transport in the Middle East and Gulf states. Her project is entitled Military Mobilities and Mobilizing Movements in the Middle East. Well, that's a lot of M's in that, yeah. Huh? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
I know. My daughter loves alliteration, so.
Okay. So this project will examine the role of war, trade, and commerce, and struggles over citizenship and labor rights in the making of ports, transport, infrastructure, and shipping in the Middle East. It aims to provide a socio-historical account of the emergence of the technologically grand projects of things like harbor dredging, port building, shipping, and the accumulation of capital in transport, and also to trace the role of migrant workers, military logistics personnel, finance and insurance brokers, and local and faraway powers in these ventures. So tonight, she will speak on a small part of that, the logics of counterinsurgency. So please join me in welcoming Laleh Khalili.
I always love coming to Georgetown. It feels, actually, of all the universities in the US, feels in some ways closest to my home institution, SOAS, in very strange sorts of ways. For one thing, it is one of few universities where people actually pronounce my name correctly, and so from everything about it is wonderful, of course, that's really lovely. I want to thank Rochelle, I want to thank all of you, and I want to especially thank Tara, who's been amazing in organizing my trip here, so thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here again. The project actually is going to not really have directly a lot to do with counterinsurgency, the one that I'm working on right now, but I don't think I've quite spent my interest on counterinsurgency, and so when Rochelle was suggesting that maybe I could do something that could connect in some ways to my previous work, which some of the students in her courses have read, I thought that it would be interesting to talk about the ways in which my current project on transportation infrastructures has some bearings on my past project, which is much more about the fighting of counterinsurgencies. Okay, so I want to start with a clip that is going to be familiar to some of you, and
they let us win.
It's very frivolous.
They take everything we had, and not just from us, from our fathers, and from our fathers' fathers.
And from our fathers' fathers' fathers.
Yeah.
And from our fathers' 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 fathers.
You're a stone, don't labor the point. And what have they ever given us in return?
The aqueduct.
What?
The aqueduct.
Oh, yeah, they did give us that. That's true, yeah.
And the sanitation.
Oh, yeah, the sanitation, Reg. Remember what the city used to be like?
Yeah, all right, I'll grant you, the aqueduct and the sanitation are two things the Romans have done.
And the roads.
Well, yeah, obviously the roads. I mean, the roads go without saying, don't they? But apart from the sanitation, the aqueduct and the roads...
Irrigation.
Okay, so... I'm not entirely sure. Actually, I assume everybody knows Monty Python, but that's for a younger generation. I'm not sure that's entirely true. But it's the famous scene where, what have the Romans done for us ever? And I love The Life of Brian. I think it's one of the most wonderfully transgressive political films there ever was. And that scene has always bothered me, because what have the Romans done for us? Well, they gave us the aqueduct, sanitation, and roads. And so in some ways, what I'm going to talk about today is going to be a kind of a response to The Life of Brian. I've always found the clip deeply resonant and at once deeply inadequate. The idea that an imperial power leaves behind fundamental infrastructures is one that would have meant a great deal to the men of Monty Python, all of them educated in those British institutions that trained men for ruling the colonies, as well as my own institution, of course. As if the job of empire was to spread civilization through infrastructure. But of course, the statement is utterly inadequate, as in its celebration of the empire, it says nothing about its costs, or that the collateral benefits were first and foremost intended as weapons. The statement about the roads, the aqueduct, sanitation, ignores the fundamental and irreplaceable use of such infrastructures, both tactically and strategically, to imperial militaries engaged in pacifying intransigent populations in asymmetric warfare, and the incorporation of conquered peoples and places into extensive systems of rule. Infrastructures were necessary both tactically and strategically, and perhaps more importantly, politically. Historians of military logistics tell us that when armies moved across the surface of the continents, they were followed by a crowd of roughly 50 to 150% their size, of people providing a whole range of commercial services to this moving army, commercial and logistical services to this army. Napoleon was so successful in the wars he fought, not only because he had a great strategic mind, but because he had at hand a formidable administrative apparatus that ensured supplies for his army were not requisitioned forcibly from the European villages and towns that were conquered, as had been the common practice before then, but sent from behind the lines by the first trains reserved for such processes. In other locales, including Egypt and Syria, and this painting is by one of his contemporaries of the conquest of Egypt, and later Russia, where he failed, his failure was as much a flaw in his logistical planning and enforceable requisition and plunder of local goods needed to supply his army as the actual exigencies of battle. In fact, it was a Napoleonic innovation in European land wars to send commissionaries ahead of the military in order to organize the resource of this or that town and set up a market. And of course, on particular military terrain, which was often fought over, for permanent bases to be established. The diffusion and proliferation of roads and other means of transport, markets, and civilian institutions have in the vast majority of instances gone hand in hand with war making. And the infrastructure of the market is also the same infrastructure used for war fighting. So wars, while destroying so much, have also been the underlying engine of economic and political transformations that are not always visible. Military historians, for example, trace the emergence of the vast network of railroads across Western Europe to the logistics lines that fed the different sides of European wars, often fought by the French and Prussians as far back as Napoleon, but especially during the Franco-Prussian wars of the mid to late 19th century. And these logistics lines that fed the different sides of European wars were the ones that actually formed the foundation of what we recognize as the interrailing system in Europe. The extensive highway system that so characterizes transportation in the United States has always had to do with the supply lines that fed and clothed the conquerors of indigenous lands there. In fact, many of the highways in the West follow those traces of the original Indian War supply lines. And even today, the impetus for construction of new roads and highways comes from the necessary infrastructural support demanded by the defense and aerospace industries and the vast network of military and intelligence bases in the country. In the Middle East, Aden and Basra, the great ports of the Middle East, alongside, of course, Beirut and Alexandria, became the significant ports that they did in the course of the 19th and early 20th century, because they were not only transit points, coaling and bunkering stations. Bunkering is fuel oil for ships. Entrepôts and transshipment ports for goods coming from India, but also because the British Empire's vast network of naval hegemony and control required fuel, food, and supply way stations. So this was the port of Aden in the late 19th century. But counterinsurgencies differ from conventional warfare in several crucial respects. Counterinsurgencies are not only massively asymmetrical, i.e. one side is more superior in firepower to the other, they're also unconventional, i.e. a formal military fights an unconventional or guerrilla or insurgent force. Counterinsurgencies are as much about pacification of civilian populations as they are about the defeat of guerrilla forces. As the greatest guru of US counterinsurgency, David Kilcullen, has written in an article aimed at US warfighters, interaction with civilians lies at the heart of counterinsurgency. I'm quoting now from him. This is the true meaning of the phrase hearts and minds, which comprises two separate components. Hearts means persuading people their best interests are served by your success. Minds means convincing them that you can protect them and that resisting you is pointless. Note that neither concept, this is still Kilcullen speaking, note that neither concept has to do with whether people like you. Calculated self-interest, not emotion, is what counts, end quote. In his other writing, Kilcullen clearly lays out the tactical logics of guerrilla defeat. The logistics of counterinsurgency are perhaps as significant as the actual processes of war fighting, not only because logistics, transportation of goods and materiel, provides sustainment to forces, not only because they're sometimes the only thing that remains, as the Roman aqueducts and roads did, but also because the very process of logistics provision does a political work. So it's not the objects themselves, but even the process, or not only the objects themselves, but the very process of making logistical infrastructures that ends up doing political work. What I will do in the time that remains is to first mention some ways in which the process of logistical support for the war on terror has embedded the war in a whole series of commercial and economic networks whose wartime expansion has resulted in consolidation of particular economic forms. I will then next attend to road building specifically in counterinsurgencies, first by reflecting on what direct kinetic or violent functions road building serves, or roads serve, and finally by their political meaning and significance. So next is maritime and air movements. The US war on terror demanded that vast numbers of troops and materiel be transported to Afghanistan, to Iraq, and to regional supporting bases in places like Kuwait, Bahrain, Qatar, and other places scattered around the region, including Diego Garcia, and pre-positioned naval floating bases, which are essentially big ships with logistical material on them, from bases and depots in the US and elsewhere before they could be put on trucks and shipped via roads to forward operating bases, forward operating bases being where the warfighters went on from to fight or to patrol. I do want to briefly mention the role of commercial or civilian infrastructures in supporting this activity because it will substantiate the final argument I'm hoping to make here. The extraordinary significance of commercial transport infrastructure can be demonstrated via two different vignettes. The first has to do with the ways in which the US has managed to get vast amounts of materiel and personnel into place or out of Afghanistan. This is despite the sabotage or official closures of supply routes through Pakistan and the Central Asian countries that neighbor Afghanistan, and the difficulty of transporting vast amounts of materiel to a landlocked country, which has very few roads and has an extremely mountainous terrain. So in order to get stuff into Afghanistan, this has involved the use of Dubai, or more specifically, the port of Jebel Ali as a node for transport. This is the port of Jebel Ali. Jebel Ali is the eighth largest container port in the world. All the other ports ahead of it are in either China or Southeast Asia. And its proximity to the Maktoum Airport, which will eventually become the major commercial airport in Dubai, its vast warehouses, and its extraordinarily high security means that it is perfect as a site for the transport of materiel. It's in the 2 years that I have been traveling there, I tried to get on to Jebel Ali port. I've been to so many ports in the Middle East. And it has been the only port that I've been denied entry from the land side. So in order to get into it, I got onto a container ship, and the container ship, actually, I got off of it at Jabal Ali. And even then, I couldn't. It's the only port I have seen where the ship, when it berths at the port, at the harbor, a barrier, an electrified fence, separates the berths from the port proper. So it is the most secure port I have ever seen, in the Middle East, anyway. As a DOD Inspector General report shows, Jabal Ali is the eighth largest container port, and precisely because of all those reasons, the Maktoum Airport, again, this is important because of this slide, and because it has a lot of space for warehouses, it has been very crucial to the U.S. transport command and logistical support for Afghanistan. As a DOD Inspector General report shows, the commercial, this is again quoting from the report, so forgive me the managerial speak. The commercial multimodal contractors fly cargo from Afghanistan to the Al Maktoum International Airport, where they clean and stage the cargo while obtaining clearance from the UAE government. After contractors clean the cargo, U.S. Customs and Border Clearance agents inspected for clearance into the United States. So they have the U.S. Customs agents are in situ in Jabal Ali. Once the contractors obtain clearance from the U.S. Customs people and the UAE government, they tarp and move the cargo to the Jabal Ali seaport. So from the Maktoum airport to the Jabal Ali seaport, it's across the street, more or less. I mean, if the street is a couple of miles. Where it is loaded onto a vessel for further movement to its final destination. The contract for this process has been worth $1.4 billion and was given to five logistics contractors, all of whom were headquartered in the U.S. So despite the fact that Jabal Ali has one of the most extensive logistics infrastructures and largest number of logistics firms there, the companies that got those contracts were U.S.-based. The second means of commercial integration into the process of military logistics provision has been the use of commercial vessels as part of logistical movement of U.S. materiel. So container ships, ro-ros being roll-on, roll-off big ships that carry vehicles, and they can usually carry cars, trucks, in this case actually tanks, armored personnel carriers, etc. Barge carriers and others, in the transportation of materiel and heavy vehicles and large cargo. This has especially been the case in the 1991 war against Iraq, but has continued in various elements of the US war on terror as well. And it has been pretty extraordinary because of this research that I've been doing, I've been looking at the work of commercial firms in the region and have discovered that, for example, DHL in Kuwait ramped up its personnel by something like 10,000 people when the U.S. was drawing down from Iraq, and that DHL in Bahrain, their largest client for the last 10 years, has continued to be the U.S. Fifth Fleet. So some of these big commercial firms, essentially their biggest contracts come from the U.S., and essentially what they're doing is they're providing logistical support to the bases there. I will speak about what the meaning of this is later, but for now, let's just point out that the kind of sea lift or drawdown deployment that these commercial ventures embody are not at all limited to counterinsurgency warfare, but road building is far more significant to both the tactics and larger political strategies of a counterinsurgency. Roads are the sine qua non of war fighting. They are crucial for the transport of goods, weapons, and personnel. They're of course used by tanks and armored personnel carriers. They're often the surfaces via which soldiers patrol the area surrounding them. They're of course as crucial to guerrilla or insurgent forces as they are to the counterinsurgents. Perhaps the most famous of these insurgent supply routes is the Ho Chi Minh Trail, which is, there's an image of it there, which was so central to the logistical support of the National Front for the Liberation of South Vietnam by the government of North Vietnam, that in order to destroy it, the U.S. flew nearly 1,000 sorties a month and dropped tens of thousands of tons of explosives and later chemicals that acted as both defoliants and soil alteration agents on both Vietnam, North Vietnam, and on Laos, a country on which it had not even declared war. Counterinsurgents have their own usages for roads, and the two instances I want to speak about are Afghanistan and Palestine, because though similar, they also have distinctions having to do with the settler colonial system of the latter, and therefore the different political uses of the roads in the two cases. Afghanistan has before the 2002 invasion, had 12,000 kilometers of paved road, which is a very small volume of roads given the vastness of the country. And since 2002, the U.S. has built around 1,500, the U.S. military has built another 1,500 kilometers, with other donors, including USAID and NATO, adding an additional 1,500 kilometers. So about 3,000 kilometers have been added to that original 12,000. In Afghanistan, roads were considered so significant to warfighting that the vast majority of the emergency funds of local commanders since 2001, has been spent on road building. So all the emergency fund that they have, the vast majority of it has gone to road building. In many instances, the roads that are being built or resurfaced or maintained are actually continuations of roads that were originally built in the 1960s by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers in Afghanistan itself. And they were considered to be necessary Cold War infrastructure, necessary not only because it was, of course, Afghanistan butted up against Soviet Union, but also because the roads were necessary for should there ever be any need to supply Shah's Iran, which was the U.S.'s biggest ally in the region. Afghanistan was a very useful place to have a support infrastructure. And so there's a vast amount of information about the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers building these roads. And in fact, having had that knowledge was very necessary to the road building processes of the U.S. military after 2001, because they essentially went back into the archives and pulled out all of the blueprints and engineering materials that had been used in the 1960s. The new Afghan roads built since 2001 connect the largest cities to supply routes to Afghanistan, while the Herat to Mashhad, Herat to Iran border, actually that has been built by the Iranian government, and specifically by the Iranian government's their construction arm that is connected to the Revolutionary Guards. Although that has been intended as a means for facilitating thus far, as a means for facilitating pilgrimage and commerce between Mashhad and Herat. It hasn't had military uses yet, by Iranians anyway. As David Kilcullen, the aforementioned counterinsurgency guru, wrote in 2008, and I quote again, he's imminently quotable. He writes very well and very articulately. He's a very articulate theorist of counterinsurgency. Like the Romans, see, there was a reason why I chose Life of Brian. Like the Romans, I'm quoting Kilcullen, counterinsurgents through history have engaged in road building as a tool for projecting military force, extending governance and the rule of law, enhancing political communication and bringing economic development, health and education to the population. Clearly, roads that are patrolled by friendly forces or secured by local allies also have the tactical benefit of channeling and restricting insurgent movement and compartmenting terrain across which guerrillas could otherwise move freely. But the political impact of road building is even more striking than its tactical effect, end quote. Roads not only function as means of movement and transport of troops and materiel, they also connect, and this has been really important in the case of Afghanistan, connect provincial places and far-flung habitations to administrative centers. Part of the nation-building process has been establishing a very centralized and coherent central government. And for this reason, building roads to further out provincial centers and connecting them to Kabul has been quite significant in trying to sort of reinforce this kind of a centralizing impulse. They are a means of economic integration as they allow for transportation between sites of production and markets. And along with electricity, potable water, and irrigation, roads can always be presented to intransigent populations as counterinsurgency, in counterinsurgencies, as means of persuading civilians to believe in the rightness of the cause of counterinsurgents. We're good guys, we're giving you roads, you know, what have the Romans done for us? The extent to which local trade and goods can travel on these roads and the extent to which the safety of these roads is reflected in the lower cost of shipping of consumer goods is also a measure of the success of counterinsurgencies. So, for example, RAND has a big report about how to measure the success of counterinsurgencies, and one of the most significant things is to first measure the safety of the roads, and second, evaluate the cost of transport of goods by roads. And if the costs are going down, then counterinsurgency must be succeeding. If the costs are going up, then counterinsurgencies must be failing because you're spending a lot on security, you're spending a lot of money on transport. Tactically, as Kilcullen has written, roads can also be used as offensive means by separating the guerrilla from the population. Kilcullen writes, and I quote again, "Instead of being in the villages among the people, the insurgents are now forced up into the sparsely populated and often uninhabited hills. This has political as well as security effects. The population gets a visual impression of the enemy firing down into the valley where they live, and the security forces defending the villages, rather than as previously the enemy living in the villages, and the security forces attacking the villages to get at the enemy." End quote. He does not mention that this separation, this pushing of guerrillas up into the mountain, has also the effect of literally starving the guerrilla forces, as they're separated from the civilians who can support them with victuals and medicines. This is one of those things that often is not spoken about, but when counterinsurgents speak, or they don't speak about it explicitly, but when counterinsurgents speak about separating the guerrillas from the population, what they essentially mean is denying the guerrillas food. So most of the defoliants, for example, like Agent Orange that were used in Vietnam, were used to both to destroy the cover of guerrillas, but also to actually destroy the small sort of ad hoc farms they had set up in the forests of Vietnam. And so there's a huge element of food denial that goes into the separation of guerrillas from the people. Kilcullen also mentions that roads compartment the terrain, thus gridding the territory to be controlled and pacified by the counterinsurgents. And this compartmentalization of terrain is absolutely significant, is absolutely central in Palestine. The function that those kind of compartmenting of grids perform in counterinsurgencies is performed very, very significantly by bypass roads in occupied Palestine, and specifically the West Bank. These roads, which are built jointly by the Israeli ministries of defense and transport, serve additional functions. They are certainly intended as means of compartmenting the terrain, as Kilcullen mentioned, and they provide a workable infrastructure for frequent military operations of the Israeli military. Israel has built more than 1,700 kilometers of bypass roads, primarily used by Israeli settlers and citizens. Let's pause for a moment. Afghanistan has a surface area which is 115 times the size of West Bank, and the Israeli military has built, so, you know, 115th, it should have built 115th the number of roads the U.S. built in Afghanistan, but they actually built half as many miles. So essentially the volume of roads that the Israelis have built, the Israeli military has built as a means of controlling the land is extraordinary given the size of the West Bank. The roads facilitate the movement of troops and armored vehicles, but they also allow for gridding and mapping of the West Bank. This process of mapping is hugely significant as information, data, maps, visual cues, and various other forms of military or intelligence knowledge is central to the process of counterinsurgency. Further, the roads allow for compartmentalization of the West Bank into variegated areas in which to which different access regimes apply, but also different rules of engagement, i.e. who can fire where, as well as different legal regimes under which legal system they are. And there are so many different, there's a palimpsest of different layers of variation. So you've got areas A, B, and C, which were Oslo inventions, but then you have seam zones, you have free fire zones, you have a whole series of other politically differentiated and administered areas which result in vast bureaucracies of occupation with confusing and impossible to navigate permit regimes that further restrict the movement of Palestinians. And you often hear about checkpoints being significant to these, but roads are far more significant actually as means of making these divisions work. As activists have written, while originally developed, Originally developed Palestinian roads, so the roads that Palestinians built organically between their villages, conformed to the natural topography of the area, connecting Palestinian habitations and hamlets and towns to one another and to farmlands and coastal and inland cities. The bypass roads, I have a really good picture, there's one. The bypass roads blow through hills and farmlands, connecting settlements to cities inside the Green Line, and in essence overlay the organic landscape. They really do blow through the landscape, as you can see. This is Route 443. Their security is considered to be so paramount that in many instances, Palestinian roads which intersect the bypass roads, Palestinians who are traveling on Palestinian roads which intersect the bypass roads are not allowed to cross them. And in many instances, even where the endless checkpoints, earth mounds, they're the checkpoints, earth mounds, fences, like this, on Palestinian roads can be negotiated quickly, avoiding a bypass road can add 20 to 40 kilometers to a trip that is often a quarter that length. The bypass roads are also considered to be a means of security for settlers in the West Bank. And given the centrality of settlers as a kind of civilian auxiliary to the military, whether or not they want to be, and of the settlements as a component of the military occupation and security architecture of the West Bank, the roads augment these functions. Given the settler colonial character of Israeli domination in Palestine, the roads also serve additional counterinsurgency functions. They're intended not only to control the population movements, as I've mentioned, they're specifically aimed at expropriation of land. Approximately 41,525 acres of Palestinian land has been confiscated to sustain these 1,700 kilometers of roads. The roads very often cut through olive groves and result in destruction of Palestinian farmlands and communities. This process of expropriation is so central to the function of the roads that in many instances where the Israeli state has been taken to court, and where they haven't even been able to defend their use through the use of Israeli military regulations, the Israeli military has actually appealed to Jordanian law in order to expropriate these lands under eminent domain Jordanian laws. So they're using Jordanian laws that applied to the West Bank before 1967 in order to expropriate land for military functions after 1967. Palestinian-only roads, in turn, are subjected to closures, blocking, destruction, and complete encirclement. But both in Palestine and in Afghanistan, as in dozens of countries before them, subjected to counterinsurgencies and wars of pacifications, roads don't simply serve tactical or immediate military functions. They're instruments of political transformation and of social engineering. Some of these political shifts are even embedded in the very military tactical processes of expropriation, mapping, or changes in mobility patterns. But they affect longer-lasting changes that are not as visible, and which I want to reflect on by both through the historical comparisons and some lovely reflections by Foucault. One of the clearest articulation of the view of road as civilization, or as a civilizing function, was that of Marshal Bugeaud, who invaded and colonized Algeria in the 19th century. In his assessment of his Algerian adversaries, Bugeaud claimed that Arabs, and I quote, have none of those major centers of government, population, and commerce at the heart of a civilized country, nor any of those large arteries that circulate the life of civilized nations. No inland points, no major roads, no factories, no villages. So this idea that the road was a kind of an artery of civilization was something that he articulated very, very clearly. Roads, markets, and school were considered to be as vectors of civilization and as the trinity that would allow the incorporation and pacification of indigenous populations. Hubert Lyautey, who had pacified Indochina, Madagascar, and later Morocco, similarly acclaims roads as instruments of civilization, where their development allows covering the country in military convoys and goods, and allows for economic exploitation and development of commerce. These come from lectures he himself gave. Indeed, in Morocco, Lyautey boasted of building 1,500 kilometers of new roads as a means of connecting Morocco to Algeria and Tunisia, and seaports to inland cities, facilitating at once the incorporation of Morocco into a military security regime of administration and control, and the commercial networks that undid and redid the colony in the image of the metropole. The construction process itself is an extraordinary modality for the transformation of labor regimes, though in very different sorts of ways in different places and times. In Madagascar, for example, where communal and village labor was mostly agricultural, the new colonial regime of the French created a wage-laboring proletariat that were forced into corvée labor to build the roads, from the very first establishing the racialized regimes of work characteristic of colonialism. In Morocco, by contrast, under Lyoti, German prisoners of war engineered the roads alongside Moroccan wage laborers. On the one hand, the French asserted their continental supremacy over defeated enemies, in this instance Germany, and on the other hand, created a racially striated work regime on the road building sites. In other places, including in Afghanistan, road building has employed the locals in sites of internal or civil conflict, thus co-opting some segment of the population into the system of economic reproduction the counterinsurgents put into place. This segmented employment process, where they very specifically talk about in the road building strategies, talk about specifically hiring people of one particular ethnic group or tribe, as they often appeal to that, it draws on ethnic or national or linguistic differences and allows for the processes of divide and rule or the divide and co-opt to control the populations. This even extends to the bypass roads, where the Israeli Ministry of Transport occasionally employs Palestinians in dire financial need to work on the road's construction, thus actually making this population quite suspect in the eyes of their co-citizens. These labor regimes not only incorporate the population to be pacified into new economic constellations of work, they also make them beholden to the regimes of power in place. In fact, as Priya Satya has written about the earlier development programs in Iraq, technologies such as dams and modern roads would not only produce battlefields from Mesopotamia's disordered landscape, but also produce Mesopotamia itself, Iraq, as a geographical and political object. A road-building project also consolidates dominant institutions of power. This is not only the nation-state, although the role of the nation-state or the metropolitan power is enormously important. In counterinsurgencies, such projects also produce power constellations the counterinsurgency as beneficial proxies for them. Here, Kilcullen is again instructive. He writes about Afghanistan, and I quote again, "The road project involves a series of negotiated agreements with tribal and district elders. The approach of the PRT, provisional, I can't remember what the R stands for, some R, thank you, provisional reconstruction team is taking, the approach that the PRT is taking is to make an agreement with the elders to construct a portion of the road that runs through their tribal territory. This has allowed them to better understand the geographical and functional limits of each elder's authority and to give the people a sense of ownership over the road. Since a local workforce has constructed it and is then paid to protect it, they're more likely to defend it against Taliban attacks. Also, the project generates disputes over access, resources, timing, pay, labor, etc., that have to be resolved between tribes and community groups, and this allows Afghan government representatives to take the lead in resolving issues and negotiating settlements, thereby connecting the population to the provincial and local administration and demonstrating the tangible benefits of supporting the government," end quote. This insistence on tribes and tribal leaders as the prevalent and legitimate power holders in the region strangely echoes the Sandeman system deployed by the British Imperial officer Robert Sandeman in Balochistan, whereby tribal leaders were made responsible for the safety of roads from bandits, or if you want to call them informal tax collectors, and for the implementation of British colonial policy. The system, in essence, consolidated tribal leaders' power over the ordinary tribesmen while making the leaders themselves beholden to the colonial masters. As a proxy system of rule, the Sandeman system was considered less costly than direct forms of domination, certainly less costly than the butcher and bolt system that the British also deployed in the Northwest frontier. Though its effectiveness had been debated even as early as then by colonialists, imperialists, and counterinsurgents. In many instances, This consolidation of state power and prevalent social forms of domination has been intended to facilitate the creation of market economies. Certainly, as I mentioned earlier, markets, roads, and schools were considered the primary vectors of civilization by the French colonizers. And the extent to which roads, rails, and ports, and new legal regimes around property ownership and work transformed the British colonial holdings also points to the significance the British placed on transportation routes as means of shifting the ground under socioeconomic relations to be undone and redone in the image of the metropole. In fact, many of the train systems in some of the former British colonies were established as means of bringing out goods from the center, but they were also often put in order to, as means of pacification. The fact that in Afghanistan, roads were seen as a means of strengthening market exposure for the farmers and pastoralists, and in fact the extent to which trade over such roads was used as a singularly important measure of counterinsurgency success, points to the inextricability of counterinsurgency warfare and market economies, or commerce. In his reflection on the development of regimes of security as a fundamental element of modernity and modern spread of nation-state form and capitalism, Foucault writes at length about public hygiene, for example, as a mode of control of urban areas. He also writes that as important as systems of public health, perhaps even more important, are the systems of control and discipline and security embodied in the police. He has a very long reflection on what the functions of police are, and he ends his reflection by writing, and I quote, "Finally, the last object of police is circulation, the circulation of goods, of the product of men's activity. This circulation should be understood first of all in the sense of the material instruments with which it must be provided. Thus, police will be concerned with the condition and development of roads and with the navigability of rivers and canals, etc." In his Traité de droit public, I apologize for my crap French, Donat devotes a chapter to this question, which is called Of Police, the full title being Of Police for the Use of Seas, Rivers, Bridges, Roads, Public Squares, Major Routes, and Other Public Places. So the space of circulation is a privileged object for police. But by circulation, we should understand not only this material network that allows the circulation of goods and possibly of men, but also the circulation itself, that is to say, the set of regulations, constraints and limits, or the facilities and encouragements that will allow the circulation of men and things in the kingdom and possibly beyond its borders. From this stems those typical police regulations, some of which seek to suppress vagrancy, others to facilitate the circulation of goods in this or that direction, and others that want to prevent qualified workers from leaving their place of work or especially the kingdom. After health and the object of bare necessity, after the population itself, this whole field of circulation will become the object of police, end quote. So the significance of circulation as the object of police is something that he really insists on. Circulation is so central to capitalism that the whole of Marx's second volume of Capital and good bits of the third volume, as well as some of the best bits of the Grundrisse, are dedicated to reflections on the annihilation of space by time, or of circulation. The ability of mechanical modes of transportation and communication to defeat time through the speeding the delivery of goods to markets. But also, as importantly, the ways in which the very fact of circulation subjectivizes the worker, the citizen, the subject of modern state, capitalism, or nationhood apparatus. The ways in which roads provide an impetus for laws and regulation. Roads built on ground surface whose ownership status as property is sometimes in the hands of the state, but increasingly in those of corporations or some overlap between the two, facilitate transport and communication. They also they facilitate telecommunications because roads have already got, they've already been built, they already have very clear locations, and often because their property status has been determined, they're also used as kind of the space through which you lay down cables, for example, for internet, before that for the telegraph. Roads are then, alongside maritime transport, embodiments of circulation of commodities and capital par excellence. And every road built by an imperial power reinforces the economic system advanced by that power as much as any other forms of control or incentive or discipline. That is why the inextricability of military logistics from commercial enterprise, going back even to the use of commercial firms or commercial ports, is so significant in this regard. This fungibility between infrastructures for capital accumulation and those for war fighting is fundamental to the era we live in, and an irrevocable element of what constitutes infrastructural power of those who own the formations and the facilities. This infrastructural power facilitates extraction, circulation, and accumulation, but so very often its origins lies in the violence of war making. Thank you very much. I'm not sure whether internet works, but if it does, may not. Okay, well, there was a really great video of Roman police circulating in a square, but sadly,
so we have time for questions. If you would come, that one's missing a mic. Oh, you've got it there, Rusu. If you would come to here so that we can hear your question, so that the whole audience could hear your question, and then if you could just line up there, that would be great. And you can have a seat, Laleh, thank you. And field questions and.
From the microphone, yeah.
Yeah, I think that great. Will be on. Well, I think we're recording it, so I think you might want to. Sorry.
So thank you so much. That was very enlightening. And for as someone very interested in warfare, it was great to see this part of warfare. I'm interested in something you didn't discuss, which is this continuity across space and across time of modalities of road making from Afghanistan to colonial India. You've got Palestine and so on and so forth in East Asia as well. And so what I'm interested in is, you know, this almost makes it seem like it's just been a triumphant practice across that space and time without any impediments either faced in resistance or in failures. Mm. And so what is the synergies, if any, between them that inform road making as we see it today?
That's a very good question. Unfortunately, you're right that I didn't include anything about the ways in which these roads actually can also provide enormous objects of either resistance, sabotage, interdiction, and loads of other ways from the moment actually they're planned all the way to the moment they're used. So from the moment of planning, there is obviously huge amounts of struggle over the property that has to be confiscated in order for the roads to become part of some system of some system of accumulation or some system of war fighting, part of the state, etc. Everywhere that the governments or the states or the war fighters or whoever has gone in to build roads, there has been inevitably struggle over land. Because of course what it does is it cuts through different properties in many instances, it divides a single property into multiple properties. In this, in particular, in the case of farmlands, is quite detrimental to the actual work of it. In pastoral places, it totally destroys the possibility of the movement of pastoralists across the roads. For example, when in Iran in the 1950s they built roads in one particular southwestern part of the country, which was very heavy on pastoralists, the number of losses to pastoralists' cattle and sheep was extraordinary because they just couldn't navigate the road so easily as it was. So it's a contested thing from the moment of planning down to the moment of construction, where if you have corvée labor, there's wonderful accounts from Madagascar where people do slowdowns or just don't do a very good job with building roads, all the way, of course, to the moment of use. And one of the texts that I was reading was saying that bridges and pipelines are the three most effective objects of sabotage. So, of course, IEDs in both Iraq and Afghanistan were considered to be enormously detrimental to the job of transport of goods and materiel. And one of the interesting things that I didn't read from Kilcullen was that building asphalt roads with very large shoulders actually prevented the planting of IEDs. So So there's a constant struggle over these, and it's not a triumphant procession, but I have to say it is actually a much more triumphant procession than many of the other large-scale infrastructure projects, because very often the roads are also, they are a means of incorporating populations. They are a means of subjectivizing them into the systems of control. And in very many instances, the roads do facilitate commerce, and so there are people who disproportionately benefit from it within a given community, and those people who disproportionately benefit from the roads are going to be behind building it, including people like the tribal leaders in Afghanistan, so, or the contractors who get nice, cushy contracts for building them.
Okay, Stanley Kober, Georgetown alum. What interests me here is more the logistics of the insurgency, and this is something I've puzzled over. They don't have the road building equipment.
No.
They don't have all the stuff, and yet they can deliver. I mentioned this once in an article in Afghanistan. How do they do it?
Yeah. It's a very good question.
I'm baffled.
Well, one of the fundamental characteristics of an insurgent is, of course, the fact that they have small arms, they don't have heavy vehicles, and they very often have connections to the regions from in which they fight. So one means of obviously separate, one means of the guerrilla allowing or provisioning, allowing for the movement of logistical goods, everything from medicine to what you need in order to survive, let's say, out in the hills, tents, or food or whatever, is provided by the populations in which you're embedded. I mean, that's Mao's old thing about the gorilla being like a fish in the water. And of course, that was a counterinsurgent's response, is that if you want to kill the fish, you drain the pond. And so you separate this insurgent from the population. Because ultimately, not needing roads in order, because they don't have personnel armor, armored personnel carriers, they just have small arms. They can walk everywhere, or they can use, actually the thing that they use very often are those Toyota trucks, which can go over any terrain. And so modes of transport are completely different. Whereas if you have massive tanks or armored personnel carriers, or you're moving often 10 to 20 times as many people as the insurgents are, you need a lot more roads. There's one other factor, I think, which is quite interesting in the wars the U.S. in particular fights, the U.S. counterinsurgencies, is that the U.S. provides an enormous amount of force protection for its soldiers. So essentially, for every soldier, you have also an entire apparatus of force protection, which goes from simple things like the Kevlar vests or whatever technology it is that they have now, they wear to all sorts of other things that, for example, protect the places they stay in, that makes their places less fireproof or less vulnerable. And those things also then require to be carried. And so in some ways, the very kind of philosophies of counterinsurgency at a very tactical level end up requiring an enormous amount of stuff, which a guerrilla doesn't need. So. I mean, that is the one advantage of being a guerrilla, is you don't have very many things. You just depend on the population to provide you with your food, and you carry your small arms. So.
Hi, thank you so much for a fascinating presentation. So I have a question. It kind of picks up where you left off. It's sort of the opposite of sabotage, but one of your first examples on Vietnam was about the destruction of infrastructure by the imperial power or by the settler colonial state. And I wonder whether you're looking at that as well, because I'm thinking here about like U.S. involvement or even Gaza, kind of the explicit destruction of infrastructure as a means of control.
Yes, I am actually looking at that, because I think that is really quite significant. One of the things that has been very interesting in the current Saudi plus allies war in Yemen has been the extent to which they have bombed ports, for example, and that has been and the ports have actually been some of the first places that Al-Qaeda, for example, Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula has fought over. That has also been the case in Libya, where ports and oil terminals have been the objects most fought over, and also the ones that are most targeted by bombings, etc. So they are means of starving or isolating or limiting the access of the population to external to external places, whether those are means of places which can provide a kind of support by sending in materiel or sending in personnel, or what whatever, just cutting off transport. Cutting off contact. But what is interesting is that more often than not, those kinds of destructive events are immediately followed by constructions of those very same facilities. Because if you destroy it in order to invade it, but then if you want to control it at all, you need those same infrastructures that you destroyed. And so some of the very first things you bombed is what you end up putting back into place. And it is really interesting, because if you read back some of the planning things, for example, bombings of roads or ports or airports or whatever, while they're planning the bombing, they're also getting out the blueprints for the airports. So this was particularly the case in Iraq, because they needed it in order to be able to land their very large carrier airplanes in there, and they had the blueprints, because many of these places have been constructed either by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers or by American or British contractors. So.
Thank you very much for the enlightening talk.
Pleasure.
I was wondering if you had thought about the long railroad that the British left in Iran.
Yes.
And if it was, my first question is, was it truly built for the same purpose? Was it truly
yes.
built? Okay.
Definitely.
So now, almost 40 years after the Islamic uprising, and since the nature of comprador capitalism has changed in Iran, do you believe that it still serves the same function, or could it have the same function?
It's a very good question.
I had another question.
Okay.
What you started with was Monty Python, and I think one question that goes into the heart of that is the question of modernity. And do you think all this infrastructure has advanced the cause of modernity in a sense, but has it come in a great price?
Okay. The railroads were built as a means of military control. There was no question about it. I've been going through some of the British National Archives, as well as the India Office records, where of course their political residency or political agency was first in Bushehr in Iran. And it's very interesting that the British are constantly upset that they simply don't have the kind of access that they need into the heartland of Iran in a way that they do in Iraq. And they talk about this, it's very openly. And then of course that railroad was absolutely necessary for being the supply line to Soviet Union during the Second World War. The Umm Qasr port in Iraq was similarly first planned by the British as a way of bringing in goods to Iraq during the Second World War, and now, of course, it's their largest container port. So it's really interesting, because in many instances, these infrastructures do arrive actually into the region around the Second World War, and they're meant as a form of war fighting, essentially, necessary instrument of war fighting. Do the railroads serve the same function today? I suspect not. I actually haven't studied Iran and the military. I'm not entirely sure when they went to, for example, suppress insurgencies in Kurdistan, or they occasionally go into Balochistan. I'm not sure whether or not they use railroads to send the troops. I don't think they do. So I think it doesn't serve the same function. I think it's a much more commercial enterprise now, and I think you can see an element of that being very significant by the fact that the Chinese are now talking about investing into the rail system in Iran in a big way, actually. The Chinese are really, really interested in that. And so I think it serves a different function. It serves to also incorporate Iran into a different system of capital accumulation, which has China at its core, and the whole new one belt, one road policy that they have. Roads is a function of modernity. I think that the reason that I started with the Romans is because I think that roads have always served this imperial function as a kind of a military function. I think what distinguishes modern roads from their Roman counterparts, or from pre-modern counterparts, is what Foucault talks about, which is that they serve not only as a kind of a functional instrument, not only as something that you use to move stuff about with, but that they also serve as a kind of a political or political economic kind of an instrument, in the sense that you make a polity, you make the people, you make the objects around the road, you make the laws around them, you make the systems around them, in a way that the road becomes a politics machine rather than just simply an instrument of conquest. Although, having said that, the incorporation of far-flung places into the empire and their accessibility was absolutely also crucial to the Romans. But I don't think that it served quite the same element of subjectification then than a modern road does, with all the ways in which it fits into disciplinary systems of policing and security, et cetera, et cetera.
Thanks so much. I think my question builds sort of just on those comments. And I wanted, the details you have are really wonderful, and I was wondering if we could come back to this final part where you're talking about the meaning of all of this and the links between counterinsurgency and practices of war making and security. And one of my questions was sort of helping me to understand the intuitive logic of the Foucault reading of policing in the guise of counterinsurgency, and there's been a lot of recent literature that's done a great job of linking policing practices to military practices, and I just wondered if in that sort of linking the ideas of Foucault's policing to this apparatus, which is ostensibly war making, if you were intervening in that sort of discussion, and if you could help me to sort of see the connections.
I think that's, having worked on counterinsurgency now for God knows nearly a decade, it means that I don't always do the job of explanation that is absolutely necessary. And you're absolutely asking about a really, really crucial link. I think one of the things that distinguishes a liberal counterinsurgency from other forms of counterinsurgency and also from other forms of military, other forms of warfare, conventional warfare in particular, is the fact that it, at its heart, it has, and it confesses to, it has a policing function, in the sense that it sees itself not just as a way of fighting, but as a way of policing. We associate policing with disciplinary forms of control and systems that are coherent and considered to be legitimate. We consider warfighting slightly different in that regard. And counterinsurgents draw on the very same fundamental elements which we associate with policing, questions of legitimacy, questions of coherence, questions of control over civilians, questions of modalities of insertion into the lives of civilians that is not necessarily always associated with kind of the destructive work of war. And I think that counterinsurgents themselves consider their job to be policing. That overlap is completely and totally accepted to be the case. Liberal counterinsurgents. I don't think that the Russians in Chechnya or Syria and its various things considers itself to be liberal. They just are interested in the destruction rather than in the policing element, which I really do interpret in the Foucauldian sense, which is a disciplinary apparatus intended to transform the civilian population as much as it is to keep them disciplined.